Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. A while ago, I made an unboxing video of my Skywatcher Skymax 150 Pro telescope. And then a while after that, I made a second video covering the Skywatcher replacement focuser that I bought to use with the telescope. Now, I've used all of this kit for a little while now, and I've looked at a range of targets, deep sky and planetary, and I thought I'd come back and give you my impressions on what the scope's actually like to own. Okay, now it's based, my impressions of this scope are based on a sample of just one, this particular telescope, and of course your views may differ, but anyway, let's give it a go. What did I think of the Skymax? Okay, so firstly, the positives. Mechanically, it's a very solid telescope with a decent paint finish. It's well screwed together. I really like the paint finish on the scope, the sort of spangly, sparkly effect that you get on these Pro Series telescopes. Feels very solid. When you buy the scope, the bundled eyepiece and diagonal, I'd say they're quite lightweight, but they're decent. Certainly usable accessories, quite pleased with how these performed. Useful that the eyepiece, 28mm focal length, so it's sort of moderate power, quite a usable eyepiece when you're first locating some targets with the Skymax. Even though I made a second video about a replacement focuser, I'd say that the standard focuser on the Skymax is actually more precise than I'd expected. It's quite easy to use. Obviously it's a single speed focuser, so it's not going to be what you need for precise focusing if you're looking at webcam imaging, for example the planets, but for normal visual use and otherwise it's a nice focuser to use, very positive, very little image shift that I can see with this particular telescope. Scope itself, well obviously Maksutov's famous for being planetary telescopes. And I'd say it is excellent for looking at the planets and the moon when it's cooled down, that is. We'll come back to that. The image scale that you get with the 1800mm focal length really gets you where you need to be. And a slow focal ratio of f12, it's really not a problem with bright objects like the moon and the bright planets. So it really is a very good scope for the planets and the moon. More than that though, it's only strength. I've had quite a good look at some brighter deep sky objects. For example, I've looked at the Ring Nebula and I've looked at some globular clusters, and those objects are relatively bright and the views have been really pretty pleasing. They're not quite as sharp, the views, as you get with a refractor telescope, but they're really not that far off, and surprisingly good views, I would say, of those small objects. Okay, now for some downsides. This scope is not grab and go like a 90 or 127mm Maksutov. The scope and the finder weigh 6.5 kilos, and you add another kilo for a focuser like this and you've got 7.5 kilo scope. You remember that a Celestron C6 telescope, Maksutov Cassegrain, by comparison would weigh 4.5 kilo. So this is a chunky bit of kit, albeit one that's well screwed together. So, if you plan to use one of these, you need the right mount. Preferably, I'd say an HEQ5 class of mount, if you plan to do any photography. An EQ5 is really marginal, as far as I'm concerned. Okay for visual work, it's not going to be any good with astrophotography. There's just too much mass in this scope, especially when you put on cameras, focusers, all the other accessories we like to attach to our telescopes if you're doing astrophotography. At the front of the Skymax, there is a heavy lump of glass. Obviously, it's part of the optical design of the scope, and it is a dew magnet. It attracts dew very well. So, in order to solve this, I've bought a AstroZap dew shield like this. You can buy one of these or many variations on it. It's cheap, simple, and it works, but you will need a dew shield if you're going to use the Skymax on anything other than a very dry night. Cooldown time. Now, this caught me out when I first started using the Skymax on planets. The corrector plate, once again, at the front of the telescope is a major contributor to this. You need a good hour of cooldown time if you're going to do any precise work at high magnification. It takes that length of time to reach equilibrium. Now, you can work around this if you can store the scope maybe in a shed or in an unheated garage, then it gets you halfway there. But if you're going to bring it outside from inside, initially from the temperature of your house into the garden, you're going to find you've got to wait quite a long time for it to cool down. It's a Maksutov, so well, I guess a small field of view, can I count that as a downside or just perhaps a feature? I'd say when you're using it, unless you've got a go-to scope, the small field of view, obviously you've got to work a bit harder to find targets. Now the 9x50 finder is really pretty good. It gathers quite a lot of light and you can see a lot of stars, which help you when you're finding your objects. But I would say it's useful to supplement that. I use a red dot finder as well, which can help you with the initial targeting of getting the scope in the eyepiece, getting the target in the eyepiece. Otherwise, it can be quite frustrating moving backwards and forwards if you don't have a go-to scope. Once again, Maksutov feature, it's got a slow focal ratio. What this means is if you're looking at any extended object visually, it's going to be dim. There is nothing wide field about this scope. Not really a surprise if you're in the market for one of these, I guess, but it's worth mentioning. And finally, well, I'd like to see a carrying handle. Often you're grappling to put one of these to connect the dovetail onto your mount, and it would be really good to have a built-in solid carrying handle to make you feel a little bit more confident when you're screwing everything together in the darkness. But having said that, that's a criticism you could level at an awful lot of telescopes, and it's quite possible that you could put some sort of carrying handle on that yourself with a little bit of work. Okay, so in conclusion, what do I think? I'd say if you already have a mount that can handle the weight of the Skymax and the bulk of the Skymax, and you can plan your observing sessions to allow for the scope to cool down, then really no planet is safe. It lives up to its reputation of being an excellent planetary scope. I'd say though, maybe if you find yourself having to take advantage of short bits of time to grab an odd hour here or there to carry your kit outside, maybe you want to view a range of objects or image a range of objects, and you don't have a long time to fit your astronomy into your day, then maybe you might find a faster scope more versatile, and maybe a smaller or cheaper Maksutov could be a better value for money. I'd caution, perhaps one thing I caution against, getting aperture fever when your finger's hovering over the order button. If you're thinking maybe, should I get a 127 or a 150? The 150 is a little bit more money, but it's going to be amazingly better performance. I think you've got to just be a little bit careful there. Think whether you've got the equipment to support it already, an adequate mount. This is quite a grown-up scope. It's a quite a bulky, heavy item, and really, you can't rush it. So I'd say so far, I like the Skymax, definitely, but I don't love it. Maybe it'll grow on me when the planets are a little bit higher in the sky. We'll see. But for now, it's a good scope. As long as you're aware of, like everything else, no scope does everything. And this is really no different. Okay, I hope that's useful. Thanks for watching.